Psalm 119, and that's verses 57 to 64. You are my portion, Lord. I have promised to obey your words. I have sought your face with all my heart. Be gracious to me according to your promise. I have considered my ways and have turned my steps to your statutes. I will hasten and not delay to obey your commands. Though the wicked bind me with ropes, I will not forget your law. At midnight, I rise to give you thanks for all your righteous laws. I am a friend to all who fear you, to all who follow your precepts. The earth is filled with your love, Lord. Teach me your decrees. Our second reading can be found on page 783, and that's Luke 10, verse 38 to 42. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha had opened her home to him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had been made. She came to him and asked, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me." "Martha, Martha," the Lord answered, "you are worried and upset about many things, but few things are needed, or indeed only one. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her." This is the word of the Lord.
Well done, man. And welcome. If you're new to CCB, visiting, perhaps looking for a church, my name's Andy. I'm the minister here. And I'd love it if you can keep this Bible passage open from Luke chapter 10, page 783. We've been journeying through Luke's gospel, bit by bit, not skipping any passages. And this is the one for us today. And I think it's brilliantly appropriate because the setup team this morning, maybe not realise, only had half an hour to set up because we couldn't get into the lockup. Which is why everything's been slightly chaotic and shambolic this morning. But thank you so much for bearing with us. And thank you to the setup team. You've done a fantastic job getting everything done. And this is the passage, which is so appropriate for us. Isn't God good? He's going to speak right to our hearts. So Father, I pray, would you do just that as your spirit speaks through this passage. Show us the Lord Jesus Christ. Show us our need for him. And please, Father, give us a delight to serve him from his grace. Amen. Now, we live in a culture which is undeniably performance driven. And you see this most in the workplace, don't you? With performance reviews, kind of tracking measurable outcomes, performance related bonuses, which depends whether or not you get your extra money that year. And constant, I don't even notice this, performance-related chat. You know, the water cooler, everyone's saying, "Oh, I'm really up against it at the moment. Really busy at this moment," which is a sort of humble brag, isn't it? Way of letting everyone know that I'm very important and I'm very, very needed. Performance-related culture. And it can be very ugly. It can be really ugly. Just imagine when someone else gets that bonus you're hoping for. Or when you get passed over for promotion, or when you lose your job, then many of these things aren't just frustrating setbacks inevitable in a city life. These things can often strike at the very heart of our identity, can't they? But it's not just work that we tend to be performance driven. It's not just work. A couple of years ago, I read this article from the New York Times. It was called In Praise of Mediocrity, and that immediately drew my attention. It's written by a guy called Tim Wu, who's a professor, law professor at Columbia University, USA. And the article is all about how performance culture is now infiltrating the world of leisure. Here's what he wrote. "If you're a jogger, it's not enough to just cruise around the block. You're training for the next marathon. If you're a painter, you're no longer passing a pleasant afternoon, just you, your watercolors and your water lilies. You are trying to land a gallery show or at least garner a respectable social media following. When your identity is linked to your hobby, you're a yogi, you're a surfer, you're a rock climber. You better be good at it. Or what are you?" Very perceptive, isn't it? We see performance culture at work. We see it at play. But what about performance culture here at church? Could we be deriving our value or sense of self-worth from what we do here? Well, surely not, Andy, I hear you cry. Surely not. Nell's crying it out, never mind. Surely not. No. This is a Bible teaching church, we say. We believe in salvation by faith alone, by grace alone. And we go, yes, of course we do. But all too often we don't apply those doctrines to the area of our service. We kind of keep them relegated to the area of salvation and redemption, but we forget to apply them to this area of life. Tom mentioned earlier in our confession, last week's passage kind of torpedoed the idea that we can justify ourselves by our performance. But in today's passage, Jesus applies the very same truths to the area of our ministry to one another. You see, here's the thing. Here's the headline, if you're with me. We are not only saved by grace alone, we also serve by grace alone. And I want to tell you, this is wonderfully, wonderfully liberating, especially in a morning we've had. So since, if you look down, since the end of chapter 9, Jesus' face has been resolutely set on Jerusalem, hasn't it? And at some point along the way, he stops at this village of Bethany. He and his 12 disciples and a large crowd of others have been following him along the road. So look at verse 38, if you would. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. Now, the fact that Martha would open her home to Jesus is in itself remarkable. You remember when Jesus sent out the 72 disciples on mission as messengers of peace, proclaimers of peace? He said, wherever you go, if people open up their home to you, well, you know that they are sons and daughters of peace. And this home here is just like that. We're told it belongs to Martha, which indicates she's either a single woman or she's a widow, belongs to Martha. In fact, that's her name in Aramaic. Her name in Aramaic means mistress. She's the mistress of the house, the lady of the house. So no doubt Martha, she's considered a massive honor that the Lord would stay with her. It's an honor. But also, let's face it, massive pressure. I mean, you can imagine the chat at the village well earlier in the day. Oh, Martha, I see that you're hosting some friends. Are they family out of town? Oh no. It's the Son of God. Yes, he's the Redeemer of Israel and the Savior of all mankind. Wow. Well, what are you serving him for dinner? Your beef stroganoff? No. I think I'm probably going to have to pull out all the stops. It's what one has to do for deity. So I'm hoping to do something really fancy. And that's exactly what she does. The portrait we get of Martha is that she is the hostess with the mostess. She is, you know the type, diligent, detailed, dedicated. She's the sort of person who never forgets a birthday and always sends a card. You know the type, don't you? Mary, on the other hand, her little sister, well, she's a different character altogether. Look at verse 39. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her to help me. See, Mary's never had to shoulder the heavy burden of being the eldest in the family, the heavy burden of being mistress of the household. There's always been fewer expectations placed on Mary. So unsurprisingly, Mary's not feeling the pressure at all. She's just there enjoying the day, enjoying Jesus. It's familiar sibling tension ground, isn't it? I'm the youngest of four children. And whenever we get together, the constant chat is, oh, Andy always gets the easiest way. You know, mum and dad always do go the extra mile for Andy, not for us. Hands up if you're a younger sibling. Is that true of you? No, okay, well, most of us, yeah. Hands up if you're an older sibling. Is that true of your little sister or little brother? Yeah, okay. Familiar ground, isn't it? Mary and Martha are both believers in Jesus Christ. But what I want to do the next 15, 20 minutes or so is to simply compare their different priorities. Because by doing so, I think we're going to gain some really helpful insights for ourselves. We're going to spend the vast majority of our time on Martha, okay? And we see that she seems to be serving for her salvation. Now, that might seem a bit strong, so I need maybe persuade you of that. We're told in verse 40 that she is distracted, or literally in the Greek, dragged away by her preparations. There's just so many things that have to get done. There's so many dishes that have to get prepared. And so she's there. She's giving. She's giving. She's giving. But never getting anything in. She's serving, serving, serving Jesus. But not enjoying Jesus or receiving from Jesus. I don't know if you know this book, Dangerous Calling, by Ted Tripp. It's one of a really brilliant book on ministry. I highly recommend it. And in this book, the author, Ted Tripp, he tells this story about a friend of his who's a rose expert. And he's in his garden day in, day out, pruning and protecting and nourishing his rose bushes. And when he's not in the garden at nighttime, he's in his study, researching everything there is to know about roses. And over time, his wife and his kids begin to see less and less of him. But his rose garden flourishes and it becomes like the talk of the town, talk of the community. But then one morning, or one evening, after hours of work in his rose garden, he's washing his hands by the kitchen sink, looking out through the window at his work. And he catches himself, he realizes something. It struck him that the one thing he hadn't done for years is actually enjoy the roses. His ministry, if you like, to the roses had come to displace his enjoyment of the roses. Now, this is really common, a problem amongst pastors, amongst church elders, amongst connect group leaders, anyone whose job it is to teach the Bible, that we divorce our head and our hands from our hearts. And we might be busy, busy, busy teaching others about God when we ourselves might lack awe or praise or prayer or joy. Now, speaking personally, reading this passage, I see a lot of Martha in myself. I'm a younger sibling. Yeah, I see a lot of Martha in myself here. So if you ever pray for me or the staff team or the elders team, please pray that our ministry to God doesn't ever displace our enjoyment of God. But we can actually broaden this observations wider, not you know, to all sort of ministry roles, all serving roles, can't we? And generally speaking, the folk at church I tend to worry about are those of you who we only ever see when you're on a rota to serve. That's the only time we ever see you. And that means you rarely really get a Sunday when you can enjoy sitting under God's word without distraction. If that's you, if you see, actually, that might be me. I'm only really here when I'm down to serve on something. Well, ask yourself why that is. It could be a variety of different reasons for it, couldn't it? I guess that it could be the sinful desire to keep up appearances and the sinful desire to look the right part. And it might be that. Or maybe you've got a genuine desire to serve, but you're simply distracted by all the other pressures of life. Family who want to see you, friends you want to hang out with, you need to tidy your flat, whatever it might be. You're distracted, so you struggle to come. You see, even away from church, I think it's all too easy to allow busyness to distract us from the Lord. Crossway, a book publishers, they did a bunch of research recently on our prayer lives, and they surveyed hundreds of thousands of people. And their observation is that the number one impediment, the number one thing blocking our prayer life is just this, distraction. We're distracted, we're busy. So Martha's words here in verse 40, if you look down, they indicate she's not just distracted, but she's also embittered. She's embittered. She says, verse 40, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her to help me." Now, one level, this is entirely justifiable, isn't it? And again, every elder sibling in the room is going, "Yeah, come on." Is it, you know, we can understand her sort of frustration here. It is annoying, isn't it, when you discover you're the muggins doing all the hard work. Yeah, and everyone else is sort of freeloading. It's sort of flashbacks of GCSE chemistry. Do you ever have that? You know, you're the one doing the experiment, and or maybe you're the guy sort of burning Bunsen, you know, messing around with the Bunsen burner. We know that sort of familiar scene, don't we? And there's a guy called Maximilian Ringelmann, who's a social scientist, and he did lots of work on this. It's called the Ringelmann effect. And he got a bunch of people to pull a rope as hard as they possibly could, and he measured how hard they pulled. And then he kept adding more people to the rope and then measured how hard each of them pulled. And he observed that the more people you add to the rope, the less each person pulls. The Ringelmann effect is also known as social loafing, which is great. Now, when it comes to church life, on one level, that's a natural thing we should expect to see. We all have different strengths, different capacities. And it's good that we want to help the weaker members amongst us. We can't all possibly pull with the same strength. We can't. It's good that we see something of this. Case in point, Ransford. I'm going to embarrass you. Ransford helped Tanya move house yesterday. And that's a solid oak unit. And so's the wardrobe. One of the great things about CCB is that nearly everyone is serving in some capacity, nearly everybody. And I'm grateful we're not a church where, you know, 10% of the people are doing 90% of the work. We're not there. We're not there, are we? Most of us are doing something. But of course, there is still some social loafing, isn't there? Of course there is. Sometimes it is the same people who drop off the rota last minute. And inevitably, it usually is the same people who then step in to fill that breach and come early and stay late or go out with the kids. And again, the impact of it is they're distracted because they're always serving. And it can lead to frustration, can't it? But in our frustration, it must not lead us to bitterness. Martha's speech in verse 40 is incredibly self-centered. She mentions herself four times. She even charges Jesus with not caring, of lacking compassion, which is quite a weighty charge, isn't it? I don't know if you've ever thought about it, but self-pity is just a different species of pride. In the previous passage, the law expert, he was obviously very proud, wasn't he? He was saying, look at me, I'm entitled because of my great performance. Whereas Martha is the flip side of the same coin. She's saying, pity me. I'm entitled because I've suffered so much. Older sister Martha is very much like the older brother in the story of the Good Samaritan. Because their anger at the younger sibling is used to justify themselves. Bitterness, I guess, can reveal itself in churches in lots of different ways. I've served in lots of different churches in different ways, and I guess we've seen it in lots of different ways, haven't we? I see it when staff get angry or frustrated with people in the church when they let them down, and we have to keep reminding people they're volunteers. They're divvying their time willingly. They're not employed. They're not contracted. They're volunteers. Got to keep remembering that. We see it when people use their busyness for God to justify their sin against God. I'm deserved a little bit of pornography. because I do so much for God. That's often how it begins, isn't it? Justifying it to ourselves. Jules spoke last week on singleness in the afternoon. It was a fantastic talk, and she was really honest and open about a time when she felt really bitter and angry. Around 10 years ago, she was a newly qualified teacher and also serving as a small group leader. And if you don't know, that's a very tiring combination. And there was another woman in the church, exactly the same point in her career, newly qualified teacher, also serving as a Connect Group leader. But this lady kept on being given the evening off by her husband, who thought she was overdoing it and she was too tired to come and kept saying, no, you stay at home this tonight. And Jules was honest. She said, I was really angry about that. And I didn't have anyone to advocate for me like that at the time. And she shared that for a while she harbored that resentment. We all need to make sure we have friends, don't we, who advocate for us, who tell us that cut back a bit. You're doing too much. Connect group leaders, we should watch out for that in our groups. The other thing Jesus describes about Martha in verse 41 is that she's worried and upset. Well, she's anxious and troubled. Are you anxious and troubled? It's clear, isn't it, that in some way Martha's trying, she's sort of tying her value and her self-worth to her performance. She's wondering, what if I burn all these dishes? Or what if the dishes come out late? What would Jesus think of me then? Jesus needs me not to fail. She thinks everything is hanging on her and her performance. And that, friends, is a perfect recipe for anxiety. Decades ago, I was serving in a church with this phenomenally talented musician, and he led the worship most weeks and was happy to do so, and it was always excellent. But then one Sunday, I think he fluffed the introduction to the song, as we often do. I think he began in the wrong key, and there's a bit of an awkward titter, and then they began and started again. But he had a nervous breakdown. He didn't come back to church for months. It turns out his whole identity was built around being the music guy at church. And then one public failure and his entire identity collapsed. And I relate to that. As a preacher, I'm tempted to justify myself through my preaching. And so on a day when I think I've done well and I've had lots of time to prepare, I'd sit down and I feel quite happy. On a day when I don't think I've performed so well, I go down and I feel a bit crushed and low. And it's wonderful, Bill Wilson, whose funeral was on Friday, he would often counsel me by saying, when you sit down to preach, don't ask yourself, what did I think of that? Ask yourself, well, ask Jesus, Lord, what did you think of that? Very liberating. We're all tempted, aren't we? Just think about your own life. We're all tempted to justify ourselves by our own work. Hannah is often mortified when the children misbehave, and they often misbehave most at church, and sort of kind of spinning around on the floor, she's often mortified because she's wondering, what do people think of me? She finds it very hard to ask for help because she thinks that perhaps by doing so, it's a mission of failure. Now, some of us, we've been raised in homes where failure has never been an option. You've been raised in homes where you must succeed and you cannot fail. And we've carried that burden, from our school days to university days to our adult life, and it is crushing. It is absolutely crushing. If that's you, can I just say, this is a church where you can fail. This is a church which welcomes failures, and it's okay. It's okay to fail. We're a family. We know that because Jesus responds to Martha. He doesn't give her a stern, angry rebuke. He doesn't call into question her salvation and call her a failure. What does he do? Verse 41. He responds with gentleness and compassion. Martha, Martha. Really personal, isn't it? That double vocative, personal touch. Martha, Martha. You're worried and upset about so many things. But few things are needed, or indeed only one. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her. Okay, we spent most of our time looking at Martha. Now let's, more briefly, let's look at Mary's priority. If Martha was serving for her salvation, well, Mary is sitting for sustenance. Look at verse 39 again. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. Now, in our culture, we sort of breeze over that. Okay, she's sitting on the floor listening to Jesus. When Luke first wrote this, it was scandalous. That sentence is scandalous. Because sitting at the feet of a rabbi is the posture of a disciple. And back then, in the first century Jewish world, women were never, ever permitted to be disciples. They had to work next door, doing the dishes, cooking, looking after the children. Theology was the man's job. Women were not allowed to be disciples. But Jesus, does he begrudgingly put up with Mary sitting at his feet? No. He positively welcomes her, endorses her. And this fits in with everything we've seen about Jesus, isn't it, so far in this gospel? Jesus is the saviour of all mankind, Jew and Gentile, young and old, rich and poor, men and women. So please, yes, pray for Laura and the team as they do that women's ministry review. And we want to be proactive about this. We want women here at CCB to flourish and to thrive. So whilst Martha's rushing about preparing enough dishes, making sure there's enough portions to go around, Jesus says, verse 42, that Mary has chosen what is better. Or literally in the Greek, she has chosen the better portion. The better portion. So that word portion is used throughout the whole Bible to describe the different amounts of food which God gives people, or the different land that each tribal group were given, the different portion. And the problem with food, of course, is that it perishes. And the problem with the land is that it often gets lost or taken away or sold. Jesus says Mary has chosen the better portion because it will never, ever be taken away from her. So that, as Martha discovered, working for your status, working for a sense of security, is terrible. But as we heard from Psalm 119, the Lord is our portion. He is the food that sustains us for eternal life. He is the land that will never go away. And so we keep going back to him for sustenance. A while back, I was visiting someone at Tower Bridge where they're working, and I saw these adverts on the tube. Maybe you saw them if you're there. It shows two highly powered, successful people. The lady on the left looked like she's in the charity industry. The guy on the right, what does he look like, a banker or something? I don't know. But they're both reading the Wall Street Journal. There's a brilliant tagline underneath. People who don't have time to read the Wall Street Journal make time to read the Wall Street Journal. How much more is that true of the word of life? We're so busy. Of course we are. We're so busy. But these guys read the Wall Street Journal in order to be at the top of their game. We read God's word to keep going, to be sustained. The only way we're ever going to keep serving with a smile on our face is if, like Mary, we keep sitting for sustenance at his feet. Now, I don't know if this is helpful, but Crossway, the same people who did that survey on prayer, they also did a survey on our Bible reading, and they came up with this fantastic infographic. They noticed, basically, here are some of the things which we do in 30 minutes in a day. We spend 30 minutes a day doing various things, TV, social media, podcasts, whatever it might be. And they said, okay, if you just set aside 30 minutes a day for reading your Bible, well, in one day you can read Ecclesiastes. If you do that next day, you can also then read Romans. And on it goes. You can read the whole Bible in just 160 days. That sounds achievable, doesn't it, when you break it down like that? And maybe that's something you want to do with a friend. But if you're here today and maybe you're looking for a church, this is the sort of time of year lots of people hop around looking for churches, isn't it? Wherever you end up, land somewhere which is going to feed you, which is going to stretch you, which is going to equip you to understand God's word for yourself, to know him, to enjoy him, to rest on him. I think sometimes if we've read this passage, we might go away thinking, right, okay, so the thing we should do is just, like Mary, just sit on our bum and read the Bible. And so maybe I should just stop serving and stop doing anything. But that wouldn't work, would it? Suddenly that everything would collapse and nothing would happen. That can't be the correct application here. Just as it's possible to serve with the wrong motives, it's possible that we're completely lazy. That's another problem, isn't it? So that's why we need to land, very briefly, by looking at the third character in this drama. Let's examine Jesus' priority, who sacrifices for our salvation and our sustenance. It's a very little detail back in verse 38. We probably missed it. We probably skipped over it as we read it. Look at verse 38. Luke reminds us that Jesus is on the way. On the way. Where is he on the way to? Where? Jerusalem. End of the last chapter, Jesus says, my face is set like flint. It is set resolutely on Jerusalem. He is going there to sacrifice himself for you. For you. Jesus says to Martha, only one thing is needed. That is for him to serve her. You don't need your ministry to justify yourself. Let Jesus' ministry do that. You don't need to perform in order to give worth to yourself. Let Jesus' performance do that. So if you like, let Jesus host you. In a moment's time, we're going to gather around the Lord's table. Let him host you. Let him feed you as you come to him by faith. Let him serve you. And I think having been served by Jesus, having been fed by Jesus, we're then in a position to sustainably keep sacrificing ourselves for him. But we've got to get the order right. First, he serves us. Then out of the overflow, we serve him. It might be that as a result of hearing this passage, some of us want to step back from serving in a particular way. And I would actually take that as a massive win. So there might be someone here is burning out and they're struggling with the various balls they felt sort of taken on. It would be a huge win to say, actually, I'm not approaching them with the best heart. Maybe I'm going to try and do less. That would be great. It'd be a huge win also if others go, I am serving, but I'm not approaching it with the best heart. And I want to serve from a place of having been served. That would be great too. And it might be you're at church here and maybe you're just kind of sitting on the fringes of things. Maybe you're new and you're not serving in any way. And maybe you want to say, no, I want to start serving. I want to start giving. That would be a great thing too. The story is told of a husband who was incredibly, incredibly controlling of his wife. So much so that he dropped various lists and rules for her. He wrote them down and gave them to her. This is what I want you to achieve today. This is what I want you to achieve the next day. Small pernickety things, do's and don'ts, exactly how he wants his breakfast served, exactly how he wants the housework to be done. And day after day after day, she would begrudgingly obey these rules, fearing his disapproval. But after several long years, that husband died. And as time passed, the woman met another guy at church and one who dearly loved her, who treasured her, who encouraged her. Soon they were married. And this husband did everything he could to love and serve and give himself sacrificially for this woman. He constantly showered her with encouragements and tokens of his appreciation. And one day, as she was cleaning the house, she opened a drawer and she found stuffed at the back one of these long lists of do's and don'ts, a long list of laws and regulations. And she realized that even though her new husband hadn't given her any lists at all, she was actually already doing everything on this list for her new husband. She realized she was so devoted to her new man that her deepest desire was to please him, not out of fear, but out of love. The pastor, Tim Keller, once said this, and someone put it in a brilliant infographic. Glorifying God does not mean obeying him only because you have to. It means to obey him because you want to, because you are attracted to him, because you delight in him. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us a Saviour who came to serve and to give his life as a ransom for us, for all of us, whoever we are, young, old, rich, poor, men and women. Thank you that he invites us to be his disciples, to sit at his feet. And I pray that hearing your word today, feeding on him by faith as we come to the Lord's table together, you would sustain us and help us to sustainably sacrifice ourselves for him and the gospel. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.